Good morning and welcome to Countryside. The timer is at zero, which means we're going to start with our worship. So come on in and find your seat, but don't sit down. We want you to stand up and join us for worship today.
Amen.
Praise and treasures of faith are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your
is better than you.
turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways.
Talk after that. That one takes a lot of breath. We want to welcome y'all this morning, and today, right now is the time of the service where you can go around and greet each other. There's an offering box in the back if you've come prepared to give. Mr. Phil has already worn himself out going around the room during that first song, so come see Mr. Phil if you hadn't talked to him already. Wave your hand, Mr. Phil, so they know where you're at. He's not listening to me. All right. We're going to keep singing. Actually, this is one of the first songs that our praise team up here ever did for y'all way back when. I need to figure out how many years ago that was. Miss Amanda Howell will remember this one because she used to sing up here with us. Come grab a mic if you feel inclined. But we're going to sing an oldie for y'all, and y'all just welcome each other.
So relentless, I am one black perfect love, wrapped within the arms of heaven, in a peace that lasts forever, sinking deep in mercy. See, I'm wide awake, drawing close, stirred by grace, and all washing over me. Your face is all I seek. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. Your love so deep is washing over me. Your
right, we gave you all a long song to visit, so you're almost all back in your seat. You did really good. We're going to keep singing, and y'all keep joining us.
For you, he is for you, he is for you.
Blooper number one.
Hello.
Good morning. We want to welcome everybody to Countryside today. I'm Jody.
And I'm Jesse.
And we're going to go over the bulletin. We're going to have videoed announcements next week. Sam, Patton.
We gave Sam the summer off, but she's ready to go.
Dinner on the grounds today after church. So stay with us. There's also the annual business meeting after that. So that's in your bulletin.
We also need some, we have several people that have signed up, so give yourselves a good hand. Our kitchen staff is fully staffed for Wednesday night services, so good job there. We still have some classes that have no teachers, so we have some sad little kids coming in the fall if we don't get some teachers. So please sign up. There's a sign-up sheet on the back. There's lots of areas that you can serve. It's like 1.5 hours on a Wednesday night. Not hard to do. We can give you all the lesson plans. So next week, we'll start begging. So Sam, remind me in the bulletin or in the announcements to beg for that. But seriously, if you will consider helping us, please sign up on the sheet out there.
You can check your schedule for the food bus. It was here this past Friday, so it won't be here for another 2 Fridays. But if you want to take advantage of that or know anybody that could use that, 2 weeks from Friday, they'll be back.
We have some exciting news. If you are a volleyball player, I want you to come up here with me because we're going to introduce what we have of our team here. Sorry, girls, there's a lot of y'all. Come on. We just went to Delaney and Allison. Come on. We just went to Valdosta State University yesterday and Friday and Saturday, and we took this team of girls, and they not only did well, they dominated and left as the camp champs. So, yes. Y'all come on up and join them. They all have such like unique abilities in volleyball. If y'all have not come to see them play a game, this is going to be a good season. We played 2 local teams, Bell and Williston, and blew them out of the water. So they're probably going to be like out for blood whenever we play them in the regular season. So our girls are going to sharpen their tools. But we have Delaney, who is our libero and can dig any ball out of anywhere. Hallie and Sam are double threat on the net hitting. We've got Shelby, who smiles at her opponents incessantly and scares them to death with her smiles. And she also is an undefeated paper, rock, scissors to get the first ball, the first serve. So she did good. Maggie's our supermodel at the net. I'm trying to get her to understand that she's 6 foot tall and can intimidate anybody, but she stands there like with her little model pose, being all cute. And we have Allison, who can do just about anything on the court. So we have a really good team, and I wanted to introduce those. We also have Malia, who normally is here. Yay! Where's Addie? Yay! Addie's in the nursery, but we talked her into coming to the camp. She does not like staying away from home, and so she's really mad at me because I talked her into coming. But she was our secret weapon. So girlfriend did really good for her first time on varsity, but these are your varsity team. We don't have the schedule yet, but it will be out, and Mr. Phil will be in charge of giving those to everybody because he's our number one fan.
If he doesn't have it next week, I'm going to give y'all's phone, DJ, his number to everybody so y'all can harass him.
So we have a schedule coming, and Malia normally is here, and she is out on vacation, so she didn't join us in the tournament. But these are your camp champs.
Bell? Play Oak Hall, yes. They're in our district.
Bell, Williston.
Probably Bell, Williston.
Chiefland, we're playing this year, but we got a good little team. I'm excited. And it's Hallie's senior year, so I'll be crying. I'm on the countdown. Do a lap, girls. Mr. Phil wants y'all to do a lap on the way out. All right, so give them a round of applause. They are your Valdosta State camp champs.
Last couple things on the back of your bulletin. There's some release forms for the website and directory. If you could stop and grab one of those. They're actually on the welcome table out there, so you can pick one of those up. If you have any questions, you can see Miss Carol. She's probably over next door helping get the meal ready.
Home groups are in-home this week, so if you haven't found a group yet, this is probably the last in-home one, I think. So plug yourself in.
Not too late to go.
If you want some good entertainment, come to Trenton on Wednesday night. We'll give you some good entertainment in our barn. And I think Miss Ethelene has one going on at her house, which is close to Countryside, and there's another one at Mr. Louie and Miss Connie's, and Zach and Phoebe also have one. So plug in.
You tell them about communication.
Oh, Communication is important to us at Countryside, and we have a special tool to help us do this. See how good you remember your phone?
Out front on each side of the lobby, there are some on the table are some cards called communication cards. If you're a first-time guest with us, please take a minute and fill that out so we can better know how to serve you. Visitors or members, you know how you can use those too. Before we go, if you lost a phone, this was turned in from the building next door. It's got a picture, I believe, of a rose on the home screen. So I'll have it if you, all right, I'll bring it to you.
That's all we have. Good morning, and thank you for joining us today at Countryside.
I think I have a team of people that are coming up to share in song with y'all, and you all are going to join us in singing. Let's stand together and sing some great old hymns. Amen? All right, here we go. Woo-hoo!
Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groanings, of his precious blood's atoning, and I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he gave the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. He has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll see up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
My my Savior first of all. Amen. When my life work is ended and I cross the swelling tide, when the bright and glorious morning I shall see, I shall know my Redeemer when I reach the other side, and His smile will be the first to welcome me. I shall know Him, I shall know Him, and redeemed by His side I shall stand. I shall know Him, I shall know Him, by the print of the nails in His hand. Oh, the soul's thrilling rapture when I view His blessed face, and the luster of His kindly beaming eye. How my full heart will praise Him for the mercy, love, and grace that prepare for me a mansion in the sky. I shall know Him, I shall know Him, and redeemed by His side I shall stand. I shall know Him, I shall know Him, by the print of the nails in His hand. Through the gates to the city in a robe of spotless white, He will lead me where no tears will ever fall. In the glad song of ages I shall mingle with delight, but I long to meet my Savior first of all. I shall know Him, I shall know Him, and redeemed by His side I shall stand. I shall know Him, I shall know Him, by the print of the nails in His hands. Amen. This one is a fairly new song, Hymn of Heaven. Somebody asked me about it. Here we go. How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the One who bled to save me and walk with Him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before Him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with Him who died and rose again. And every prayer we pray in desperation, the songs of faith we'll sing through doubt and fear. In the end, we'll see that it was worth it when He returns to wipe away our tears. There will be a day when all will bow before Him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with He who died and rose again. Holy, holy. And on that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Yeah, the whistle is blown. The kids are going. Don't get run over in the...
I got it. Yeah, right there. Thank you, buddy. All right. Thank you for praying for Grandma Keith. She's doing well, recovering at home, and the heart procedure went so well. And thank you for all your prayers. You were just kind and gracious to do that for us. And we look forward to seeing them back when they're able to get back to church with us. Today's a pretty big day for us. We have a wonderful dinner on the grounds. The ladies have got it all ready for you next door. So when we leave here, go that way. Don't get in your car and leave. Go that way, because we don't want to take food home with us. We've got a lot of food that needs to be eaten up, and we need your help to do that. And after that, we're going to come right back here. We're going to start around 1:15 and start our annual business meeting. So if you're a member, please come back in here. And if you're a prospective member that has joined but hadn't been voted in yet, you come too, because we're going to vote you in today. So it'd be nice if you were here to participate in that as well. I want to speak for the next few minutes on the beginning of the end. Is this the beginning of the end? Really, as you look around at what's happening in America today, and it's more troubling news every day, really. Remember when Mr. Trump got in office and they were worried about him starting a war? Remember that? Oh, he's so unstable and he'll start a war, and blah, blah, you know, all that nonsense. And then this gentleman I don't know if he's a gentleman, the fellow that's in there now, we respect him because he is president, we have to respect that part, but the one that got in office somehow, that stayed in his basement for 4 years and never even campaigned, and now he is our POTUS. They don't say much about him wanting to start a war, do they? Have you noticed that? You don't see that same charge. But my brothers and sisters, we're closer to wars now than we have been. And we got China breathing down our neck now. We got Putin on the other side wanting to nuke us. And I was reading early this morning as I was doing my study, ran across an article about, I guess it was last night late, but China has put in these cell towers powered by Hawaii. I can't say that might be the wrong pronunciation, but it's spelled like Hawaii, but Hawaii is how I think it's pronounced. But it's a phone system that's all over our country now, and it carries our cell signals. And they're supposedly not be able to bug that and get into our military stuff, but it's interesting. They put all these things next to our military bases and next to where our nuke launch sites are. And some of our chief strategists are worried that once, if we ever try to launch our nukes, the Chinese will be able to control them from these cell towers, and we won't even have control of them the moment they're launched. And so we have all this stuff always popping up and wondering, what in the world's going on? In fact, I was reading the same series of articles. One of them was about the new torpedo that they have, nuclear-tipped torpedo, that they can launch somewhere in the Pacific, and it will travel by itself up near our shores, drop its nuclear load, and deactivate till they call for it. And it will be able to launch from the seabed and do its dastardly deeds against whatever enemies they decide are enemies. Of course, who is their enemy right now? We're their enemies. And they hate our guts, and they would like to destroy us. So as we read those things, and to me they're troubling things, and I'm not troubled for myself because I'm getting a little older, but I'm troubled for my grandchildren. Should the Lord tarry, and they have to live in what's coming next, I get kind of concerned about those things. And I hope we can put people in power that will keep us out of warfare and out of the danger zone, so to speak, and keep America strong. But as I was preparing this passage, I was in this sermon, is this the beginning of the end? America is not what it used to be. And as we watch our culture imploding around us and we see what's happening, and many of our lawmakers, that supposedly conservative lawmakers, jumping the ship and voting for evil things, the codifying, the stuff they codified this last week, 40-something of our supposedly conservative Republicans voted, to codify homosexual marriage and that sort of thing. I'm thinking, what in the world is going on? Well, I know what's going on. I know what's going on. What's going on is we're getting closer to the end. Jesus said at a certain point in history, he said, will the Son of Man find faith on the earth? Remember? And evil is going to get worse. You know, it's going to get a lot worse before Jesus comes. So that part, I'm okay with. I know that's coming. It's just troubling at times, and you see a lot of people that are just really worried about it. Today, I want you not to be worried, but to be encouraged, to know that God hasn't lost control. Jesus is still coming. God is still on the throne. I spoke to him this morning. I don't know if you did. I hope you did. Hope you had your quiet time. But he was still on the throne, and Jesus is still there interceding for us every single day of history. So I know it's going to be okay. I've read the end of the book, and we win in the end. But in this message today, it really comes from the Old Testament. 600 years before Christ, in the time of Daniel the prophet. And I'm going to read a few verses to you. And the first one is going to come from this troubling dream that Nebuchadnezzar had a long time ago. 600 years before Jesus, this famous king, one of the greatest kings that ever ruled, had this troubling dream. And he was in that dream, the future was revealed to him. And by revealing that dream to him and Daniel's interpretation, we gain information for our time. You say, what? Yeah, 600 years before Christ, and there's stuff for us today? Absolutely. And you'll see in a moment why. But let's begin with prayer before we read the scripture and ask God for clarification, ask God for wisdom as we read the scriptures, ask God for applications in our life. We don't need to be going around worried with her, wringing our hands. We need to be trusting our Heavenly Father to take care of us. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I know that as we talk about the things that are happening and what's happening in our world and the enemies and the threats, and sometimes, Lord, it's for humans, it's so easy for us to take our eyes off of you and begin to worry and fret and just dwell on those things instead of the positives, we dwell on the negatives. Lord, today I pray that we will dwell on the positive, the fact that you are the coming King. You are the God that loves us. You are the God that sent your Son to die for us, to preserve us when bad things come our way, and protect us, Lord, when we have to face trials and problems. You're going to take care of us, and in the end, Lord, you're going to take us safely home to heaven. So, Lord, if there's someone here today that doesn't know you yet, and they're not sure they're going to heaven when they die, I pray that they will take care of that today, and they will allow you to save them today before they leave this room. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. This troubling dream that Nebuchadnezzar had, if you go to Daniel 2, and I'm going to read it, you can read it along in your scripture, and it says, now in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, and his spirit was troubled, and his sleep left him. Now think about that. Have you ever had nightmares? Who's ever had a nightmare? Who's ever had, anybody have a dream this week? Did you remember what it was? Is it good or bad? What was it? You mind us knowing? Marco Polo, maybe? No. Not Marco. Okay, somebody else. Who had a dream this week? Back in the back. Dreamed about peanuts on Parker. You know what I dreamed? I dreamed we were in a restaurant. I don't know which one it was, but suddenly this family comes in, and the guy's dressed in a Scottish kilt. Red hair, whole family of redheaded kids, and wife redheaded, he's redheaded. And I could tell, I said, they've got either Irish or Scottish. One, they sat down over here, and I struck up a conversation. I said, are you Scottish? Yes, I'm Scottish, you know. I said, well, what's your name? He said, my name is Keith, last name Keith. I go, what? That's my name. I said, what's your first name? He said, William Keith. I go, oh my gosh, I'm William Keith too, you know. So we had this interesting conversation about the fact we came from Scotland way back, you know, and a long conversation about that and how that somehow we're connected way, way back. I don't know what that meant other than this was a cool dream. I woke up and said, funny, I just had the coolest dream. Before I forget it, I want to tell you about it. But it wasn't a troubling dream. It was not a scary dream. This king had troubling dreams. His dream bothered him immensely. And so troubling. And if you think about who this guy was, this was Nebuchadnezzar the II, and he reigned during this period of time, 605 B.C. to 562 B.C. Now, before B.C. means before Christ. They've changed it today to B.C.E., before the Common Era. Do you know why they changed it in the history books? Anybody want to know why? Or can tell me why? I hate Jesus. They don't want Jesus affiliated with it. So they took Christ off of the dates and put just before the Common Era. No, it's before Christ, B.C. Let's stick with the way it was originally written in history. But anyway, Nebuchadnezzar II, this was who it was. And you might have read about the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. It's quit on me back there, guys. Your machine went to sleep. Boop. I'm going to turn this off and on one time. Let's see if I can get it to respond. I want to run it from here, though. There we go. There we go. Okay, these were what they call the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, one of the ancient wonders of the ancient, or one of the great wonders of the ancient world. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful hanging gardens and high walls. And the tiles were a beautiful blue, stuff about Nebuchadnezzar carved into the tiles that were there. I mean, a beautiful, beautiful place. And now, of course, it's all ruins now. Our soldiers during the Gulf Wars actually have been to these, what's left of Babylon. There's nothing left because God destroyed it years later. But this was in its heyday when the children of Israel were hauled off to Babylon. They were hauled off to these beautiful big cities. And Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and some of the young men that rose up to leadership there under Nebuchadnezzar and the other leaders of Babylon, it was interesting. I always wondered, how did they get selected? Was it because maybe they had rich parents? You know how you hear about people getting promoted because of, what do they call it today, when you got family and nepotism. Yeah, maybe some kind of nepotism they got because their parents were rich and powerful. Maybe they got selected. You know, they were handsome and they were talented. They were smart. But somehow they end up in leadership in Babylon. And Daniel was one of those young men that was hauled off there and actually grew up there after that and into adulthood as one of the prophets and one of the chief prophets under Nebuchadnezzar. Now, Nebuchadnezzar demands that his wise men interpret his dreams. Look at chapter 2, verses 12, or verse 2. Chapter 2, verse 2. Then the king gave orders to call in the magicians and the conjurers and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans to tell the king his dreams. So they came in and stood before the king. The king said to them, I had a dream and my spirit is anxious to understand the dream. Then the Chaldeans spoke to the king in Aramaic, O king, live forever. Tell the dream to your servants and we will declare the interpretation. The king replied to the Chaldeans, the command from me is firm. If you do not make known to me the dream and its interpretation, you will be torn limb from limb and your houses will be made a rubbish heap. But if you declare the dream and its interpretation, you receive from me gifts and a reward and great honor. Therefore, declare to me the dream and its interpretation. They answered a second time and said, let the king tell the dream to his servants and we'll give you the interpretation. The king replied, verse 8, I know for certain that you are bargaining for time, inasmuch as you have seen that the command from me is firm, that if you do not make the dream known to me, there is only one decree for you, for you have agreed together to speak lying and corrupt words before me until the situation has changed. Therefore, tell me the dream, that I may know that you can declare to me its interpretation. Verse 10, the Chaldeans answered the king, said, there's not a man on earth who could declare the matter for the king, inasmuch as no great king or ruler has ever asked anything like this, or any magician, conjurer, or Chaldean. Moreover, the thing which the king demands is difficult, and there is no one else who could declare it to the king except gods, whose dwelling place is not with mortal flesh. Verse 12, because of this, the king became indignant and very furious, and gave orders to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. Guess what? All those boys that got promoted into high ranks and became the astrologers and the leaders are in that group that's getting ready to get wiped out. This king says, well, I'm going to kill all my wise men. You don't tell me what the dream is, I'm going to kill all of you. Daniel's in trouble. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're all in trouble. Not only the fake ones, but the real ones. God's guys are in trouble. And so we have a problem here. And you got all these wise men of that particular area, and say what kind of what were they? Well, the Beru, they call them the Beru, the wise men. They use various methods of obtaining knowledge of situations during that time. When they want to find out about the future, certain things they would do that. And they would kill animals, and they'd take the lungs of the sheep and the livers, and they would spread them out, and they would do reading what they thought they could see in the sheep livers and the lungs and stuff. That's how they would discern the times or whatever they were looking for. Sheep's and lungs and livers. One of the most widespread means of prediction was the liver omen, in which a sheep was killed, its liver and lungs examined by a specialist priest, the Beirut. He would ask a particular question, and the answer would be supplied by the interpretation of individual markings or overall shape of the liver or lungs. One could then take steps to avoid danger. Are you believing that? Cut a sheep over and get its liver and lungs. Let's look at it. I don't know if you've ever cut an animal up. Any of you ever butchered an animal? Who's butchered an animal? Some of you never experienced this wonderful thing. That part is not really fun. We butcher our own deer, okay? We've done that, our animals, our hogs and deer and stuff. We know how to do all that stuff. But we don't particularly hang around. Once we get it done, we wash our hands pretty quick. Normally wear plastic gloves because there's diseases you can catch from the blood. Brucellosis and a lot of other stuff, wild animals carry that. You have to be real careful. But here, they weren't careful. They just play in the blood and play in the liver. And, so they were sheep lungs and livers. Sometimes they found out what was going to happen or what they thought would happen by abnormal births. If you had multiple births in a family, or maybe your animal had multiple births, sometimes physiognomical omens, like bodily characteristics, if a person was born with something weird about them, or maybe your animal was born with like a cat with an extra foot or something, or an extra toe, whatever, they would take that as a sign. And astrologers, this is a sign from the gods, astrology, they would look at the stars and make predictions, sort of like the what they call them today, the signs of the zodiac. They would try to figure out what was going on. Better be careful if you're trying to find the future out with that sort of stuff, because you fall right into the same category as these false prophets of old. Sometimes dreams. Isaiah was alive during that time. Here's what Isaiah said. All the counsel you have received has only worn you out. They were just wearing themselves out, killing sheep and examining the livers and lungs. All that counsel has worn you out. Let your astrologers come forward, those stargazers who made predictions month by month. Let them save you from what's coming upon you. Surely they are like stubble, and the fire will burn them up. They cannot even save themselves from the power of the flame. And here are no coals to warm anyone. There is no fire to sit by. They're false prophets. And you need to be very careful today. If you're going to fortune tellers, or you're going to astrology, or you're trying to get someone to tell you the future, listen, don't go by any of their predictions. Anytime somebody says, "I have a word from the Lord for you," automatically I'm suspicious. And I say, "Yeah, right." I'm thinking, I'll listen, but I'm automatically skeptical. And you better be real careful this day and time. Jesus said in the latter days, many will say, "Christ is over here," or "Christ is over here." And what did he say? Don't follow them, because they're false prophets coming out of our ears today. And they were there in those days. And all these other ones that couldn't tell the dream were false prophets. And yet Daniel, the good guys, were going to get killed along with them, because nobody knew what the dream was. And they certainly, if they didn't know what the dream was, they couldn't understand how to interpret it. But here they are facing imminent death. So Daniel appeals for a little more time to interpret the dream. Look at verse 13 and following. So the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they looked for Daniel and his friends to kill them. They weren't going to escape. They were going to die too. Then Daniel replied with discretion and discernment to Arioch, the captain of the king's bodyguard, who had gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. He said to Arioch, the king's commander, "For what reason is the decree from the king so urgent?" Then Arioch informed Daniel about the matter. So Daniel went in and requested of the king that he would give him time in order that he might declare the interpretation to the king. said, King, please give me some time. And the king listened. So God reveals to Daniel, next thing that happens, look at verse 19. Then the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel said, let the name of God be blessed forever and ever, for wisdom and power belong to him. It is he who changes the times and epochs. He removes kings and establishes kings. He gives wisdom to wise men and the knowledge to the men of understanding. It is he who reveals the profound and hidden things. He knows what is in the darkness, and the light dwells with him. You see, Daniel knew who to, he knew who to seek, didn't he? And he sought the God of heaven. And he goes on to say, to you, O God of my fathers, I give thanks and praise, for you have given me wisdom and power. Even now you have made known to me what we requested of you. You have made known to us the king's matter. Verse 24. Therefore Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and spoke to him as following. Do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Take me into the king's presence, and I will declare the interpretation to the king. Good news. The good guys didn't have to die, but the bad guys didn't get killed either. See, not only saved the good guys, but he saved the bad guys. Kind of a parallel of today's time, when God's people do the right thing and they end up getting in some sort of political power or in a powerful position, many times it benefits even the lost people that are over, under them. And, you know, the Bible says when the righteous are in power, the people rejoice. But when the wicked reign, the people mourn. And we're in that kind of condition today when you have a lot of wicked people in power making all kinds of weird laws and messing all kind of weird rules, the people of God are in mourning. But when you get a good man that loves the Lord and is led by the Lord, says, then the people rejoice. In verses 31 through 45, Daniel reveals the dream and its meaning to the king. Look at verse 31. You, O king, were looking, and behold, there was a single great statue. That statue, which was large and extraordinary splendor, was standing in front of you. And its appearance was awesome. The head of that statue was made of fine gold, its breast and its arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. You continued looking until a stone was cut without hands, and it struck the statue in the feet of iron and clay and crushed them. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed all at the same time, became like chaff from the summer threshing floors, and the wind carried them away, so that not a trace of them was found. But the stone that struck the statue became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Weird dream. The statue that he saw in his dream. See, Daniel not only told him what the statue, what the dream was and what he saw, but he's going to tell him what it meant. So this was a dream. Now we will tell its interpretation before the king. You, O king, are the king of kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power, strength, and the glory. Verse 38, wherever the sons of men dwell, or the beasts of the field, or the birds of the sky, he has given them into your hand and caused you to rule over them. You are the head of gold. Now, park there for just a second. One thing to know the meaning of it is another thing what you do with it later. Okay, you can get all kinds of good information from God. You can get God can show you what the truth is, and he can fix your life. He can tell you what's going to happen, but you can sure mess up in your next few steps. You know what he does with this in the next chapter? What do you think chapter 3 holds? What did Nebuchadnezzar do? Forgot, didn't you? He built that giant 100-foot-tall gold statue of himself. That's not what this meant. But that's what he took it to mean. Well, I'm the head of gold. I'm the best king that's ever lived. And I'm going to make a statue. It'll be there forever. It'll always remind people of Nebuchadnezzar. Say, that's not why God showed him that. Not why he showed him that. He was showing him the kingdoms of the earth. Showing him, yes, you are a great king and you're the head of gold. But you're the first of great kingdom. And some other kingdoms are coming after you. And verse 39. After you will arise another kingdom inferior to you, then another kingdom of bronze which will rule over all the earth. Verse 40, then there will be a fourth kingdom as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron crushes and shatters all things, so like iron that breaks in pieces, it will crush and break all these in pieces. Think about that. He's telling him the history of the world. This dream was about the history of the world and the great kingdoms that were coming all the way up to the end of time. Do you think that was kind of privileged information God was giving Nebuchadnezzar? Yeah. Do you think that was privileged interpretation of the meaning of the dreams God gave to Daniel? Yes. You see, Daniel is a companion book to the book of Revelation. Daniel and Revelation go together. You really can't understand all of Revelation unless you combine it with Daniel, understand the prophecies of Daniel. And here's one of the main ones you need to understand. Verse 40, then there will be a fourth kingdom as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron crushes and shatters all things, so like iron that breaks in pieces, it will crush and break all these pieces. And in that you saw feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron. It will be a divided kingdom. It will have in it toughness of iron, inasmuch as you saw the iron mixed with common clay. As the toes and feet were partly iron and partly of pottery, so some of the kingdom will be strong and part of it will be brittle. And then you saw that iron mixed with common clay. They will combine with one another in the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, even as iron does not combine with pottery. Now listen, here's a key verse, verse 44 of chapter 2, one of the key verses in the scripture about the history of the world. It says, in the days of those kings, which kings? The ones that are clay and iron mixed. And it's referring right back to that verse, verse 43. You know, you saw these 10 nations that get together toward the end of time, mixed clay and iron. Some are strong, some are weak, but they're together. In the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and that kingdom will not be left for another people. It will crush and put an end to all these kingdoms, but it will itself endure forever. Inasmuch as you saw that a stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, that it crushed the iron and the bronze and the clay and the silver and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will take place in the future, so the dream is true and its interpretation is trustworthy. And you remember the rest of the story. Daniel got promoted. The three Hebrew guys got promoted. They didn't die. They got high promotions because of interpreting the dream. So what did all this mean? Well, Daniel said to him, he said, there's a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in the last days. This is Daniel 2:28. This is your dream, even the dream, the visions you had on your bed. And as he interprets the dream to him, and he sees this big image of gold, the head of gold and the chest of silver and the bronze in the middle and then the legs of iron, he's interpreting the great civilizations that were going to come on the earth. The head of gold represented the Babylonian Empire. And you can see there the map of how many nations the Babylonians controlled during that time. The chest and arms of silver, the next great world power, the Medes and Persians that came along after the Babylonians. Then the belly and thigh of brass, the Greek Empire, Alexander the Great, when he conquered the world and he wept because there was no more nations to conquer. And then the legs of iron, the Roman Empire that dominated the world up through the time of Jesus. And then the last part, the feet of iron and clay mixed. Many have called that the revived Roman Empire because it contains the same nations that the Roman Empire controlled when it was here all those years. So in reality, those 10 toes in the book of Revelation, there's a beast that comes out of the sea with 10 horns on its head, if you remember reading that. And it's the same thing. It's talking about those 10 toes. It's 10 nations. And really, it's a confederacy of 10 nations that come together toward the end of time, in the last days. And the scripture says, in the days of these kings is when it's going to happen. All the culmination of history is going to happen when this confederacy of 10 nations, the 10 toes, get together toward the end of time. And then the uncut stone strikes the image in the feet and destroys it. In Daniel 2:44, in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all the kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Verse 45, for as much as thou sawest that stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, that it break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God hath made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter, and the dream is certain, and the interpretation is sure. So, think about it. A confederacy of 10 nations. What in the world would that mean? What in the world? We've heard over my lifetime, I've heard people say it's the European common market. Maybe you've heard that term before. 7 or 8 nations in the European common. Remember that, hearing about that? You heard of the G7? Duh. That's really the old European common market. We call it the G7 today. And all the great men of the world, the presidents of the Western nations, they get together in the G7. But forget the G7. Here's what they say now. Build the D10. The moment is right for the summit of democracies. The D10. Hadn't heard about that much, have you? Not only this one, there's a group of 10 nations right now of Arab nations that have united together in a group of 10. I didn't put that, even that slide up there, but it's right on top of us. The proposed 10 nations of today in this D10 they're talking about, these are the nations. Members of the D10 strategy forum are as follows: Australia, Germany, Japan, United Kingdom, Canada, India, South Korea, United States, European Union, France, and Italy. It said, in the days of these kings. Now, could it be just coincidental that it's a group of 10 nations? Yeah, it could be coincidental. It might just be accidental. Is it accidental there are 2 D10s? I don't think so. I think God knew what was coming. And I think he knew what was going to happen on the earth long ago. And he was trying to inform Nebuchadnezzar and then Daniel and then us through Daniel in the book of Revelation what is going to come. And the fact there is a kingdom coming. What did Jesus say to pray? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done upon earth as it is in heaven. Listen, his kingdom is coming upon the earth. God is going to set up his kingdom on the earth. It's coming. It's inevitable. It has to, because mankind has wrecked the earth. Mankind has destroyed the earth. And if he's left to himself, he'll destroy the rest of the earth. Do you know what would happen if suddenly the nuclear weapons all went off at the same time on the earth? The earth would implode and melt. Because we have 2,000 or so, and the Russians have 2,000, and Chinese, no telling how many they have, and now the Arab nations have nuclear weapons, and India has nuclear weapons, and England has nuclear weapons. Listen, God has to intervene, because we're going to destroy ourselves if he doesn't. And he told us a long time ago that it's coming. See, are we living in the time of these 10 toes, these 10 kings? My own opinion? Yes. I think we are. I think it's here. I think it's close. I think the 10 nations that we're looking at over there, that's the 10 toes, I really believe. The revived Roman Empire, if you will. You can call it that if you want. If we are, this is the beginning of the end. But you know what? I'm not worried about the end. Because it's just the beginning for us. I've read the end of the story. The end for a lot of things, the end of the bad things, yeah. And got to get that bad stuff off the earth. Do you know there's going to be a time on the earth where there won't be any bad people on it? Yeah. Wouldn't you like to live in a place like that? Yeah. There are no bad people. Bad people are banished forever. Would y'all like to live there? Yeah. Well, it's not a bad thing if you're saved. Yeah, it's the end of a lot of stuff. But it's not. If you're saved, it's not bad. It's a horrible thing if you're lost. If you don't know Jesus, if you haven't turned your life over to Jesus, I'm telling you what, you better buckle up, buddy, because it's getting ready to get tough for you. It's going to be the worst period in human history coming up, and you're going to be here to inherit all that. See, the people that have wanted to have a world without God and nobody telling them what to do, the Bible, you know, we want Jesus. We don't want the Bible telling us what to do. We don't want, we'll live by our own rules. Really? Really? Okay, hold on. You're getting ready to experience that. You're going to experience a world in which God removes the Holy Spirit's power, gives it to Satan for a little period of time, and God's going to unleash his wrath upon this God-hating, Christ-rejecting world, and you're going to be living through it. The Bible calls that the Great Tribulation. It's going to be a terrible time. You will not want to live here. It's not going to be fun. Over half the people, a third of the people or so on the earth will die during that tribulation. How many we have? 6.5 billion people on the earth? 7 billion now? A third or more of those will die in the tribulation, you believe? You thinking that's a lot of burials. We had a burial here this week. One of my dear friends, Miss Judy Hale, one of our former members, godly, soul winner, loved her to death, went home to heaven. We had a service for her. And you know what? She's experiencing the joy of heaven. And she led many, many people to Christ. Many people are not going to hell because Judy Hale told them about Jesus and led them to the Savior. You don't have to go to hell if you don't want to. You don't have to live through the tribulation unless you want to. Listen, it's a horrible thing. The end of what's coming is going to be terrible if you don't know Jesus. But our purpose is so you don't have to go through that. That's why we're here. We're the lifeline. You want a lifeline? We're the lifeline right now. We want to throw you the rope. Say, here, grab a hold. We're going to keep you out of that awful place because we are attached to the Savior. And he puts the lifeline in our hands. And we've got the life ring, which is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when we throw it out there, all you got to do is grab a hold of it and ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. You know, this may be your last chance to come to Jesus. He could come today. The stones could come out of the mountain today and strike that image and begin setting up his kingdom. It could be today. I wish it was. I wish it was before lunch. But I've been praying, and I'm going to pray and work as if it's not going to be for 1,000 years, just like if he's not coming. I'm going to work that hard, okay? I'm hoping he'll come tomorrow. I'm hoping he'll come in the next 5 minutes. But I'm going to work as if he's not coming for a while, because I'm not going to take for granted that there might be somebody that I know that know Jesus that I haven't shared with yet. You got people in your family that don't know the Lord. You got friends at work that don't know the Lord. And I hope that you care enough about them to give them the gospel, to give them the good news, is they don't have to go through all this terrible stuff that's coming. I believe the rapture of the church is pretty close. I believe it's near. I believe it happens right before he destroys the nations on the earth, that stone coming out of the sky. I believe the church is gone. Boom. Some people don't believe in a literal rapture of the church. Bill Keith does. This church does. We believe in a rapture of the church, a catching away of the believers upon this earth. You remember it, when God was going to destroy the earth in a flood, what did he do? He prepared an ark. Had a man that preached for 120 years. Get on the ark, it's going to rain. Never rained before. Get on the ark, it's going to flood. And they're all going, ah, yeah, old timer. Listen, the church and the gospel right now is the ark of safety. You get on board the ark of safety, when the judgment of God falls upon the earth in the great tribulation, you're going to be riding high on the ark. The church is going out. We're going to be just as Noah and his three sons and their wives, the eight people that were saved in the old flood, they were riding high above the judgment. The church will be riding high above the judgment. Okay? But a whole lot of people, majority of the people on this earth, will miss it because they've rejected Jesus. And they won't be there. Listen, I believe the rapture is near. Your time's now if you want to be saved. Don't you put it off. Don't you leave this building. Do not leave this building if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, okay? Don't leave this building if your heart's not right with him. It's a dangerous thing to be in that condition. Stephen was telling me a few minutes ago before church, they were in the Suwannee River. Was it yesterday? Friday? They were in a tournament, fishing tournament. And all those bass boats run in the 70 and 80 miles an hour. They're fast. And they get up on the if they're running down the river, you'll see them, and they've got the boat. It'll sit like that because it's sitting right on the prop. Nothing but the prop and just a tiny bit of the boat in the water running 80 miles an hour. You don't want to hit a log. You don't want to hit a stick. You don't want to hit a wake of any kind when you're running all out, do you, Steve? The boat in front of them, there was a ski boat, and they had made a wake, and the bass boats were all taking off to their spot. So they call it the launch, everybody launching down the river. They didn't see the big wake from the ski boat. And when they hit it, it launched the bass boat up into the air 30 or 40 feet. And when it hit, so much torque was in that high, big old Mercury running at 6 or 8,000 RPMs. It snatched the boat to the side. It threw both of the guys out in the water. Now, it didn't kill them, but it hurt them. They had their flotation on, and Stephen and them were able to help rescue them, get them back in the boat. And they had to go leave the tournament, go to the hospital. Thank God they didn't die. I met a guy at the hospital one time when I was there in one of my procedures, and he was all beat up. And we started talking. I said, "What happened to you?" He said, "Bass boat wreck." I said, "Where at?" He said, "Newman's Lake." So what happened? He said, "I was running 75 or 80 and down the edge, and I hit a log, and it launched me into the trees." And he was mangled up. Didn't kill him, but he was happy. He was having fun. He was fishing. One second. Next second, he's kissing the side of a tree. It's that fat. Now, thank God, God kept him alive. I don't remember. I remember trying to talk to him about the Lord. I don't remember the rest of the story because it's been 30 years ago. And I hope he asked Jesus to be his Savior and Lord. But I know this. It'll happen to you that fast. You're not going to have time to repent when your time comes. That's why you need to do it now. Today is the day of salvation. If you hear his voice, you come today. Don't you wait. You won't have time to repent. You will not have time to repent. You think, I'll get right when I'm done doing what I want to do, and then at some time in the future, I'll turn my life over to the Lord, and I'll get things right. Yep. No, you won't. You never will. You know what will happen to you? You'll die lost, and you'll wake up in an eternity without Jesus. And if you live through it, whatever the accident you might be in, you're going to have to go through what's coming. And called the Great Tribulation, you won't want to be there. So the decision you need to make today is this. Choose to follow the Lord today. The Lord is drawing you to himself. Okay, he sent this old preacher boy. And he sent other preachers like me, and all across the land, there are invitations being given, just like right now. About this same period of time, it's about 10 to 12. All of us are wrapping up about right now. And we're given the same call all across the earth. Billy Graham did, Billy Sunday before him, Louis Giglio, all the other great preachers, James Kennedy before he died, Dr. Adrian Rogers before he died, my daddy when he was your pastor. All across the land, the call is still the same. And the call is this, that you come to Jesus now. Give Jesus your heart. Give Jesus your life. Ask Jesus to be your Savior and Lord before it's too late. Don't wait, okay? Brother Mark, are we going to have a song? Can you play a song? As this song plays, and if God's speaking to you, won't you just bow your heads and close your eyes? No, nobody looking around. This is between you and the Lord. But if that's you, if you're that person, and you say, I want Jesus to come into my life, I want you to run down here and get on that front pew quickly. Come to Jesus today. Don't wait. Daniel said, in the days of these kings shall God set up his kingdom. I believe we're in those days. You need to get ready for that kingdom, buddy. Making sure Jesus Christ is Lord of your life. Making sure you know him as your Savior. You come. Come to the front pew and just sit down right there and we'll talk to you. take it by your response that most of you here already know Jesus. I hope that's true. I hope everybody here does. But I know probably not. There's probably somebody here that you're still hanging on to your life and you want it like you got it for a little bit longer. A little bit longer. How long is too long? How much time do you have? I got a sweet buddy, my neighbor, right now battling lung cancer. Right now. He and I are fishing buddies and friends and neighbors, and pray for him. His name's Devon. I pray he knows Jesus, so he knows Jesus. And if God takes him home through this cancer, then he's ready. I pray God gives him more days, and you can do that with me. Pray for Devon. But when he went to the doctor, he didn't know he was going to be facing that. He knew he had some problems, but he didn't know he had lung cancer. So you don't know what's lurking in your life around the corner. So make sure you're ready. He's ready. Stephen and them, thank God they didn't have a wreck. When they go bass boat fishing, every time I know they're having a tournament, I say, Lord, please help them. Help them boys. They drive like maniacs. So they're fast. If you've never ridden in one of those fast bass boats, you don't understand. It's dangerous. You don't want to. I've been up around 80. I don't want to go any faster than that. No. Ricky Smith, Cheryl's brother, now he's got one that run over 100. I rode with him one time on the Swanee, and he got it up to about 85. I said, that's enough. Let it off. Bill Keith don't want to go any faster than that on the water. So anyway, if you don't know Jesus, make sure you get to know him soon. Amen? Soon. Don't put it off. You hadn't had fun yet until you ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior and you get involved in what he's doing. Now, here's a commercial for Hawthorne. Next week, 31st, right? Some of you are planning on trying to go over there and give them a little bit of a crowd. Cheryl, are y'all playing that day, right? The band will be playing. Cheryl and Glenn, we got their band put back together. So they're going to be playing some live stuff over there on that day, and they're going to be having dinner on the grounds afterwards. So I'd like for a group of our people to head over there too, okay? Are you going to be over there during church, Brother Bill Gracie? You're going to take some of our people during regular service, right? Are you going to try to do Sunday school and then go maybe? Or okay. Then go, okay. So if you'd like to be a part of that, we'd like to get a pretty good crowd there. This is their first Sunday, which will have the band. And then Chris, our young preacher boy, will be there. Christopher will be there. Fred will be there.
If you have 50 people present,
need at least 50 to be there. So they hadn't been turned on the AC in their big old beautiful church because they don't have enough people. So we'd like at least 50 to go. And see Bill Gracie, you can sign up for that. And if you do go, I mentioned to the ladies, you know, we might have a group. Said, we need to count because we don't have. I said, we'll be all right. We'll tell our people to bring food. So see Bill Gracie, and he'll hook you up with what we need to bring for that day. But it's getting exciting to see what God's doing. We're that close. The paperwork's almost signed. It's in the works right now. Two signatures away, and that's a done deal. So you pray for them. And I've spoken to both of those ones, that the signees, and they're chomping, wanting it. So God's getting ready to do something great in our midst. Amen. All right, well, let's stand and be dismissed. And then where's Brother Don Bolt? Brother Don, if you want to say, this will be the meal prayer right now. We'll do a prayer here. And y'all go that way to the gym, and it's ready to go. Pray for it.